Sally Quinn?
Yeah, I'm fascinated by the whole issue of the Trinity, which, Rich, you brought up. I don't know whether you all saw it, but I think it was Easter Sunday, Rick Warren was interviewed on the ABC morning show, and he said that he had trouble with Mormons being Christians because they didn't believe in the Trinity. And I immediately asked Rick to do a piece for On Faith about what exactly is the Trinity, and why is it so important that you have to believe in the Trinity in order to be a Christian. Then I was sitting around in our Tuesday morning religion meeting, we have 9 or 10 people, and I said to everyone, okay, what's the Trinity? And nobody could define it in a way that I was satisfied by, including one of our editors who had taught Sunday school and had actually taught the Trinity. So what I'm confused about, I've honestly, in my 5.5 years in On Faith, I have never understood the Trinity because everybody has a different view of what it is. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, Holy Ghost, what is it? And why is that so important, and why does not believing in the Trinity exclude you from being a Christian?
Just direct to me?
Well, I want to hear from both of you.
Yeah, well, I'll let Richard, if you'd go first on this one, then.
Well, for one thing, you're right, Sally. There's a range of views, and historically it's gone between modalism and tritheism. As modalism is that...
A word never used at this conference.
That there's, there's one God who appears in three modes, so that it's one God with three different job descriptions. And the other, tritheism, is that they're really these three distinct persons. And it keeps going back and forth between those.
Well, I get the two. It's the third that I have a problem.
Yeah, and as you know, there's one of my friends, Neil Planiga, has wrote a dissertation on this at Princeton, and his point was that it's easy to establish a binitarianism from the New Testament. It's a little harder to really automatically go to a Trinitarianism. But the real question, the fundamental question is, are there three persons of the Godhead, and is each worthy of worship? That's the point. And if you think about our hymns, for example, we have hymns addressed to the Father, Creator God. We have hymns addressed to the Son, Jesus keep me near the cross. There are very few hymns addressed to the Holy Spirit, although there are, Creator Spirit, by whose aid, you know, and the others. And so the question is there a third person presented in the Bible, even though a kind of less attention given to it, exegetically or expositionally, but that is worthy of worship? And the answer is yes, although it's a little harder to find the Holy Spirit part. But now, let me just link this to Mormonism and say that Mormonism talks about the three persons of the Godhead, and one of their scholars, David Paulson, who's been a part of our dialogue and a very fine philosopher and theologian, has argued that if you go back to the Cappadocians, the Greek fathers, or Turkish fathers, they were tritheists, St. Basil and others, but they called it the social doctrine of the Trinity, so that there are these three persons in eternal communion with each other. And the argument there is that David Paulson has adopted is if social Trinitarianism of the Cappadocians is acceptable within the range of Trinitarian dogma, then Mormons could eventually say we are Trinitarians. The only problem is, and if you look at the latest issue of Sunstone, which is the sort of liberal Mormon magazine, which has everything from feminist Mormons to Jungian Mormons to Freudian Mormons and New Age Mormons, it's a theme issue on the mother in heaven. And there are those who will talk about a fourth member of the Godhead. And this follows from Bob's stuff about God having human form and the like, that Jesus is the Son of God, and there must be a Father as well as a Mother. And that's there, Bob, isn't there? I mean, it's there in Mormonism. And so then you would get a kind of quaternitarianism or something like that.
What isn't there is what you described. That is a belief in four members of the Godhead. No, that isn't there. My turn?
Yeah, go ahead. Are you a Trinitarian, Bob?
I'm a believer that in the following.
Yes or no? Yes or no? Come on.
I'm a believer in the following. And this is a Book of Mormon doctrine. One, there are three persons in the Godhead. Two, each of these three persons possesses all of the divine attributes and qualities in perfection. Three, the unity and the love that exists among those three persons is of such magnitude that it is perfectly appropriate to speak of that community as one God. That's a Book of Mormon doctrine. Okay? Now, we would not go so far as to say that we believe in the ontological oneness that most traditional Christians believe in. We just happen right now, Sally, for interest's sake, we just happen to be in our dialogue right smack in the middle of our discussions of the Trinity. In fact, next month in Provo, we're back at it on the Trinity. The LDS response to our evangelical friends is always this. We have difficulty understanding how you can exclude someone from the category of Christian when, in fact, they do not accept something, and you touched on it, that very few people in any congregation understand. For that matter, very few pastors of any congregation understand.
Absolutely. That's what I'm talking.
In other words, how can something be so central to salvation that nobody understands? And you can say, well, it's a mystery. It's hard to rally around a mystery. It's hard to get people psyched about a mystery. And the other thing would be this. It eventually gets to the concept of to what extent, we've asked this, and Rich, we've talked about it, to what extent does salvation come by proper theology? To what extent, let's put it another way, how much bad theology can the grace of Christ cover?
And I'm willing to say quite a bit, but I think the real question is the sustainability of the faith. And if you know, Sally, I think quite apart from the Trinity, I really think the issue is the divinity of Christ, whether Jesus was a mere human person or the eternal Logos, the Word become flesh. And if you go back to the Arian controversy, they had a very exalted view of Jesus, but not fully God. He was homoousion, of a similar substance, but not the same, not homoousion. But gradually Unitarianism went from that very exalted Christ down to where it is today, where you know you go through Arianism to Socinianism.
We haven't touched on those here.
No, you haven't. But it you know, becomes a great teacher and then gradually becomes sort of whatever. And so the doctrine of the Trinity, while in one sense it's been very hard to formulate, it's been one of the ways in which the Christian tradition has anchored the full divinity of Christ and kept it from the kind of slippage that takes place historically when the full divinity of Christ is kind of underplayed.
And our contention would be that far more critical than, though the doctrine is very important, far more critical than correct doctrine on this is the extent to which the concept of a Godhead is lived out in the lives of the people. That is to say, Mormons pray to the Father in the name of the Son, seek the Spirit in all they do. What lack I yet in terms of my relationship to the Godhead? Do you see them?
What's wrong with what he said from a Trinitarian standpoint?
Say to Rick Warren?
Yeah, yes or no, do you think that he's Trinitarian?
No.
And if so, does that make him not a Christian?
Yeah, I guess I would say that the formulation that he just gave, we pray to the Father in the name of the Son, pleading the power of the Spirit, that sounds terrific. Question is, if the theological understructure, infrastructure of that encourages slippage, I'm not sure that it can sustain itself. I mean, I have no question. You know, I said openly in when Bob wrote his book with Erdman's on a different Jesus, and you know, question mark, different Jesus, and I wrote the foreword and the afterword because the publisher wanted to cover their tails on publishing a Mormon, and instead what it did was get me in trouble. I said at the end, I have no question in my mind that Bob Millet worships the same Jesus that I worship. You know, now is Mormonism a Christian within the realm of Christian orthodoxy? No. I've got a lot of problems with Mormonism. But I think there's a difference between a genuine devotion to Christ and a theology that over the generations can sustain that genuine devotion. I think those are two different questions. And so if you ask me what's wrong with it, no. But when he goes on to say, but we would not affirm the ontological unity, then I begin to, I worry about that, not about his soul. Which he doesn't think he has, I worry about the sustainability of that kind of formulation and that kind of practice in a community of faith.
Okay, Tim Dalrymple, is it on the Trinity, or you're taking this further?
Well, I want to make one point first, and that's that for people like Warren, and many are willing to say. And this is just kind of reframing what Dr. Mouw just said, that although I don't think Mormonism is Christianity, that's not to say that a Mormon cannot be saved, right?
Yeah,
that a Mormon
right,
can have a,
right.
a living relationship with Jesus Christ. But that doesn't mean that Mormon teaching is identical with Christian teaching.
Agreed. And,
right. So I think that's important. But it strikes me that Dr. Mouw did a great job of articulating some of the distinctives from the evangelical perspective, and Dr. Millet did a great job of rearticulating, defending to some extent one side of the ledger. And I'd just like to get some of Dr. Mao's responses, particularly on the question of theosis or divinization, and then on revelations. And whether, because I write often to evangelical audiences, and I'm a defender of Mitt Romney, and so I get a lot of the kind of the same criticisms, and also some of the same responses from Mormons. So do you find a meaningful coherence between early and Eastern church thought on theosis or divinization and Mormon teaching on that issue? And then secondly, why are there not, apart from a couple cases that you mentioned, why would it be the case that, say, after the Christian New Testament, there would not be new revelations for new times and places?
Interesting. Yeah, let me address the first one. Let me say this, that in our dialogues, we have not gotten into apologetics about the Book of Mormon, you know, horses and when it was written and the new DNA stuff and all of that. We've just set that aside. And I want to say that you can read the Book of Mormon if you forget about the historical authenticity of it. It's fairly evangelical. The Book of Mormon is basically an evangelical book. So when Bob says, I'm going to give you what the Book of Mormon tells you about the Godhead, that's great. When you go to the King Follett Discourse, which was written just toward the end or recorded, transcribed, the funeral discourse of Joseph at King Follett's memorial service, then you get into some weird stuff. So in many ways, if it had stopped at the Book of Mormon, I would have questions about it historically. But theologically, I think it's basically a Wesleyan. I mean, it has that kind of. He talks about the eternal omnipotent. All the omni attributes of God show up in the Book of Mormon: omnipotent, omniscient, and the problem with God having a form, not just having had a form in the incarnation, but having a form is you get the problem of omnipresence and all of that kind of stuff. But anyway, so your question about let me repeat the question again because I just got off. I'm sorry.
Divinization.
Yeah. So if you look at the King Follett discourse on theosis on divinization, it really seems a little weird to me.
What is the King Follett Discourse?
It was a funeral discourse that Joseph gave in 1844.
April 7th, 1844.
Right, that's
1844. And It was the one where he began to talk about the plurality of gods and the human person becoming godlike and that kind of thing. Now, in Eastern Orthodox theosis, and I think if Mormonism ever moves toward Orthodox Christianity, small O Orthodox, it's going to do it in an Eastern Orthodox, because theosis, that is the idea of divinization, becoming God, and secondly, social Trinitarianism would be the pathway in, and I'm not saying I'm praying for that or anything, although I am, but in Orthodox theology, we never become God, but that is, we more and more come to participate in the emanating divine energies.
Energies and, rather than essence.
Right. So that we're becoming God-like, but not God. And we're growing more and more into the image of Christ, the fullness of the image, and we shall be like him, and we shall see him as he is. Whereas in Mormonism, there are formulations that, and you can say it's just folk Mormonism or whatever, but there are formulations that do suggest we become gods. But I think the new Mormon scholarship is moving much more toward the idea of we participate in the emanating divine energies, because you heard Bob say, we will never be in a situation where we no longer would worship God, because we would become ourselves objects of worship. So I would say that as long as that distinction is made, but I think the ontology of Mormonism, which again, Bob has a nice way around that, but the Mormon ontology talks about the eternality of intelligence, and that God and human beings are both subject to, it's like in Plato where the demiurge is subject to the eternal forms, under the forms. God is not the creator in Mormonism. God is the fashioner of that which has always existed, you know. And that's why you have in Mormonism the denial of the doctrine of creation ex nihilo, which is central to Judaism and traditional Christianity, the world out of nothing. So there's a little more ontological messiness in it than my good friend suggests. Although I think the more they interact with Eastern Orthodoxy, the better off they are. The only problem with that is Joseph said in the report of his first vision that God himself told Joseph that their creeds are an abomination. And we're trying to rethink a little bit of that stuff as well. But it's pretty hard when you think that Eastern Orthodoxy was a part of the great apostasy, the great moving away. But there's more interaction with the Christian tradition. And you might want to say something about that, Bob.
Before he does, are there Eastern Orthodox theologians in your dialogue?
No.
No. Though it's not a bad idea.
Sure. I think it's great.
May I make a 30-second
response? Yes. And then Byron York is up, and Dan Harris, and Michelle.
I think there's the temptation, and scholars can jump to this too quickly. The temptation is to suppose that somehow the Book of Mormon comes early, and Joseph Smith and the Mormons kind of outgrow it eventually.
Can I give you a cup of coffee?
decaf, please. And that we sort of outgrow the Book of Mormon as we move into this new realm of humanity. The problem with that is there's nothing historically to suggest that. That, in other words, you don't have a de-emphasis on the Book of Mormon. You don't have the Mormons no longer quoting from it in conference. You don't have you have people putting it away. It just doesn't happen. In other words, what Kendall White was saying in his Mormon Neo-Orthodoxy, it's a lovely thought, it's just he missed it. And that is, he's assuming that this new weird concept of redemptive theology that's growing up in Mormonism is not at all like the Joseph Smith version. It's a lovely idea that he's raising, it just isn't accurate. They never outgrew it, and we haven't outgrown it. Which means, when someone says, well, how can you say that about grace, and how can you say that about atonement? Well, it's been there in the Book of Mormon all along, and we didn't leave it behind. And so, it's not a development we underwent. Okay.